Hey, I'm Ryan, a designer at Microsoft AI. There's been a lot of new features and updates in DevTools since version 1.14. In this video, I'll cover 1.15 through 1.25. At the top, I'll hit the biggest highlights and then we'll dive deeper. Feel free to use YouTube's chapters controls to jump around to whatever is important to you. I promise I won't be offended or even notice. Of course, you can also check the links in the description below for more on anything we cover today. Okay, here are some highlights from our recent releases. You might have noticed that DevTools recently got a refreshed UI in Edge 1.20. This refresh is called Focus Mode. It is designed to show you only the tools you want to see and cut down on the visual clutter while remaining fully customizable and without compromising on our feature set. Let's take a look. The top part of the UI is called the Activity Bar, which holds all the tools you want quick access to. By default, you'll still see the tools listed horizontally just as before. And if that still works best for you, cool. However, if you like how VS Code is organized instead, you can now position the activity bar to a vertical orientation. I like this setting because it creates a cleaner feel by letting the active tool really take center stage. And while we're at it, we updated some icons to make it easier to identify tools. You can add any of the 33 tools to your activity bar by just hitting the plus menu. Once you've added it, it'll stay there until you kick it out, which you can do by right-clicking on that tool to see the contextual menu and choosing Remove from Activity Bar. We also made updates to the bottom drawer, which we're now calling Quick View. Quick View lets you see a separate tool side by side with your primary tool. Just like on the Activity Bar, hit that plus menu to add a tool and right-click to remove it. Is your Quick View feeling cramped having to battle for vertical space with the tool above it? Well, now you can dock it to the right to really let it stretch its legs and take up the full height of the window. And hey, did you notice this? You can easily move tools back and forth between the drawer and the activity bar in the contextual menu. Finally, we redesigned the welcome tool to better help those who want to learn more and keep updated on what's new in each release. All right, here's another big highlight. Whether you're new to web development or have been building for some time, you probably deal with those errors and warnings in the DevTools console pretty frequently. Sometimes those messages can be rather cryptic or even scary, especially when you're learning. We're excited to share a new feature exclusively in Microsoft Edge to help bash those issues and help you get back in the flow. Now, right in DevTools, you can ask Copilot to explain console warnings and errors in your source code. To have it explain a warning or error in the console, just click the Copilot icon next to the message. To explain a code snippet in the Sources tool, select the code, right-click, and choose Ask Copilot. Explain these lines of code. We're super excited about the latest advancements in AI and how they can help you in your web development workflow. This is only the beginning, though, and with your feedback and ideas, we can't wait to build the future together. Let us know your thoughts in our DevTools GitHub community at aka.ms/devtoolsissue. In past versions of DevTools, when you collected app crashes from your users in production, it can be hard to investigate the issue because the stack traces show functions and variable names that have been minified. We introduced a new tool called Crash Analyzer, which lets you unminify production crash stack traces and understand exactly what went wrong. This tool was first introduced as an experiment in Edge 1.13 and is now available by default in 1.23. There's a bit of setup involved with this one though, so be sure to check out the link in the details for all the stuff you need to know to get going. All right, it's time for the performance power round. Helping you improve performance is always a big priority for us. With web apps, it starts by understanding where the bottlenecks are. Here are a few user experience improvements on that front. You can now zoom in on ranges of a performance trace and ignore the rest, and then navigate between those ranges by using the new breadcrumbs UI. You can change the order of the tracks and show or hide any tracks you want. There's now also a context menu on events that appear in the flame chart. The menu allows you to hide parts of the flame chart that may be irrelevant to you, cutting down on some of the noise. And finally, we've added advanced filtering capabilities in the bottom-up, call tree, and event log tabs, making it easier to find the performance events you care about. We also spent time making sure the performance tool has a minimal overhead while recording a trace. While it's impossible to completely remove the overhead, we wanted to improve on a few things. The performance tool now records performance traces more efficiently, which cuts down on that overhead. Additionally, the overhead is now visible in the trace as an event, so you can see how much of an impact it had on your recording. Investigating performance issues in a web app really depends on how much performance data you have access to. So, we also worked on exposing more useful data to the performance tool. For example, the interactions track now displays even more details about user interaction events in a trace. You can also see the fetch priority for network events, making it easier to understand why network requests happen in a particular order. The main track now shows arrows that connect performance events to their initiator events. This can be very useful, for example, to track what a style recalculation was caused by. We know complex web apps make use of multiple threads by using workers and iframes. So, the performance tool now displays events in the trace that show when the post message is used by an application to communicate between threads. Now, when working on performance, it's important to focus on specific scenarios that users experience as being slow. As a result, it's crucial to be able to run these scenarios repeatedly while recording performance so you can do a before and after fix comparison. The recorder tool, which was originally introduced in Chrome, is now available in Microsoft Edge as well. With the recorder tool, you can record these user scenarios and replay them while measuring the performance of the app over in the performance tool. Finally, we continued improving the selector stats feature of the tool. While performance is sometimes due to JavaScript code taking too many resources to run, it can also be impacted by frequent and slow style recalculations. In fact, we contributed the selector stats feature to the Chromium open source project, which Microsoft Edge is based on. So now it's not only in Edge, but in Chrome too, and any other Chromium-based browser. In doing so, we also added a new dedicated setting for enabling the selector stats feature in the performance tool. While we're on the topic of improving web fundamentals, let's talk about some new enhancements to the memory tool. Now, when making a memory recording with the allocation instrumentation on timeline option, the tool interferes much less with the app's performance. This means that the recording is a more accurate representation of the app's memory usage. Comparing multiple heap snapshots is very useful to see how memory usage changed over time. Now, after you've made a change to your app, you can see a new containment diff view. The containment diff view shows only the new objects, deleted objects, or objects in the retaining chain that will eventually lead to either a new or deleted node. The bigger change we made, which should help you make sense of heap snapshots more easily, is an experiment which allows you to report the shallow sizes of JavaScript objects in a way that more closely matches what you'd expect. In JavaScript, many objects are stored in two separate locations, a shallow object, which only contains metadata about the object, and a backing store, which contains the actual data. For these objects, it was previously difficult to understand how much memory was being used because the two locations were reported separately. Now, objects such as JavaScript arrays are reported as a single entry in heap snapshots. It's no secret. Progressive web apps work and look great on Windows, and we're making sure that the DevTools experience is just as good. You can now inspect your Windows controls overlay CSS code in DevTools directly by emulating how the WCO feature would look on various operating systems. This way, you can fine-tune your CSS layout for WCO without installing the app first and without having to test on multiple operating systems. Source maps are a huge help when debugging your app in production. They allow you to debug production problems from the comfort of your local development code. First, we improved the way to connect to the Azure Artifacts symbol server from DevTools to securely and easily retrieve source maps. You no longer need to generate personal access tokens, and you can connect to multiple different servers, customizing which source maps to retrieve from which. To make source maps even more useful across all your debugging workflows, we added source map support in the coverage tool. This way, you can see which parts of your dev code, dev code are being used in production and which parts are not. It's now also possible to evaluate original code in the console when paused at a breakpoint, thanks to source maps. All right, we're in the home stretch. Let's keep it rolling. Edge is based on the Chromium project, like I said earlier, and the following improvements were made to Chromium and are therefore now available in Edge. Along with grid and flexbox badges in the Elements tool, new subgrid badges also appear to help you find them more easily in the DOM. Selector specificity is the weighting algorithm used by the browser to decide which CSS declaration applies to an element if there are competing declarations. You can now see the specificity of a rule in the styles pane as a tooltip. The computed values of custom CSS properties, also known as CSS variables, now appear in tooltips on hover. Talking about custom properties, you can now debug the app property, which is part of the Houdini set of features that enable you to create custom typed properties which can then, for example, be animated. Meanwhile, over in the animation debugger, linear timing is supported in the easing editor. You can see scroll-driven animations in the animation panel, and CSS nesting is supported in the styles pane. Concluding the Chromium updates, several changes were made to make debugging network calls easier. You can now mock responses to requests even more easily with the streamlined override content feature. You can also override the content of fetch responses. And to help you focus on your own code, you can now also hide the requests that are due to installed browser extensions. All right, that was a lot of updates for one video. I think we'll call it there. Thank you so much for watching, being a part of our community, and helping us shape the DevTools experience. We're listening and want to hear from you, so please share your ideas and feature requests on our DevTools GitHub community at aka.ms/devtoolsissue. You can also learn more about DevTools at aka.ms/edge-devtools. And as always, like and subscribe to stay updated on everything. This has been Ryan, and you've been awesome. See you next time.